to, yeah. So I don't remember what is the lecture number. It is nth lecture number. I don't remember 13th or 14th, or I think it is 14th lecture number. So here we are going to dive much deeper into the concept of elastic scattering. So importance of this lecture can be understood from the fact that so that because it covers the important events, for example, bright field, dark field, Hadoop, selected area electron diffraction, HRTEM, what else? Yeah, and yeah, so this will cover all these topics, and yes, Rutherford backscattering also. Anything else? Change the color of the. So you can see here that different signals are described the way they originate. Let me erase it. So if you see signal number one, these are the electrons which largely go unscattered or forward scattered. So these electrons are used primarily in the bright field. And number two, these electrons are low angle elastically scattered electrons. So they are actually Bragg diffracted. So they are Bragg diffracted electrons. They are used in dark field. And also together with number one and number two, they are also used in selected area electron diffraction. So these electrons, number one, form the central bright spots, and these diffracted electrons basically form other electrons, other dots basically, which are spaced around the center spots based on their d values. And third part, high angle elastically scattered electrons, they lose their coherency. So there is no phase relation. And that is the advantage because they are not Bragg diffracted. So these electrons are used in Hadoop. And together, these electrons are used in HRTEM. And when you allow these two electrons and form image, then we call it HRTEM, okay, two beam concept. And fourth is backscattered. So they carry, these electrons carry Z contrast. And these also carry Z contrast. Why? Because you can see that these electrons are scattered when the electron incoming electrons go too close to the nucleus. Now, there are two events which are listed here, which are inelastic events, which we will not discuss in this series, but in the next series we'll discuss, because remember that we are discussing only elastic scattering events. So you can have outer shell inelastically scattered electrons and inner shell. You can see they are described by these two scattering events, but they contribute to your Auger and X-ray emissions and whatnot, okay, yields and other things, okay. Yeah, so I think so. Let us understand. So I will skip it because this is already covered. You can read those things, okay. I don't want to go into details of text, but this text I have left for students actually, okay, not for me to read out in the class. You can read. Yeah, so as I significance of these slides is basically, as I told you, that to understand this problem of elastic scattering, we need to understand the scattering from single atom first, If we understand the interaction from single atom, then we look at the collection of atoms. And this is true for X-ray diffraction, and it is true for neutron or any event. In fact, it is true for your UV visible or FTIR or anything, you know, any interaction between any probe radiation and your material. Same principle applies, that first you try to understand what is going to be the interaction with a single atom, then only you look at the collection of atom. Please follow this principle and you will be, your concepts will be as clear as deionized water. So then you can understand the interaction with specimen as a whole. Okay. So when we look at the electron scattering from multiple atoms, so we consider the electron as plane wave. Okay. So plane wave is basically the wave which has not experienced any Coulombian potential, the wave which does not have any, which has not experienced the lattice actually. So when it interacts, this wave, electron wave interacts with this these atoms, what happens is that there will be scattering, and then these wavelets are formed. So and these wavelets, they further interact with each other, whether depending upon their phase difference, and whether it is constructive or destructive, then you have zeroth order diffraction. Zeroth order diffraction is basically I explained to you the central. So this is basically zeroth order diffraction. Okay, this is called zeroth order diffraction. The central bright spot. Okay, that is called zeroth order. Okay, many people call it like direct beam, but more matured audience will call it zeroth order. Okay, and first order. So you have this n lambda is equal to 2d. I'm sorry. Is it? I don't know why this problem happens. N lambda is equal to 2d. So normally we do not consider, we consider n is equal to 1 here, because we don't consider n is equal to 2. But you can do that. Only thing is that you have to adjust d, you know, d by okay, d properly. Okay, you have to adjust d by 2 or whatever. So so second order, you can have third order, but normally we see only first order, and that is good enough for us. Okay, and so if you consider the elastic scattering from isolated atoms, so it is a repetition from the previous lecture series that if you go inside a single atom, so what you are concerned with is the electron-electron interaction and electron-nucleus interaction, okay? And these are actually hyperbolic scattering path in this equation, but not in the reality. We'll come to this point, okay? So hyperbolic means basically when the scattering cross-section becomes almost infinite. When, for example, when this is the mistake which even Rutherford, the original Rutherford experiment, he also, this formula has this problem. We'll discuss about this. So suppose this is your nucleus and the electron is coming and bombarding. So electron probability of that getting scattered, suppose electron is passing from here, so it will be less, and electron probability will become more and more when it goes close to the nucleus. And so hyperbola means electron probability, scattering probability will become infinite, you know, when it goes just straight actually. So anyway, let's not go into that dimension. So if you look at the scattering cross section, RE is equal to E divided by V theta, and it has very important consequences. So suppose you are looking for n number of electrons, so you have to multiply this by n, so it will be n times e divide by v theta, okay, re. We discussed that. So that means scattering cross section is inversely proportional to the energy. Okay, look at this. So when the energy goes up, so when you increase the electron energy, so scattering cross section becomes smaller and smaller. So that means, so holes are smaller and the bullets are faster. I think we discussed this point earlier also. So so that means if you compare 200 kilo electron volt versus 300 kilo electron volt electron energy, so scattering for this will be less, this will be more. Okay, scattering cross section, so this will have more probability of getting scattered, this electron, in comparison to this. Please note that. And second conclusion is that theta, so higher the angle of theta, so lower will be the probability of electron getting scattered. So this is again a revision that so there are more chances that electron will get forward scattered, and the probability will reduce when you increase the angle. Okay, this is incoming electron, right? This is just a repetition, right? I think you already know about this. So now you can calculate the area by multiplying it by pi r, like putting in this formula, pi r square, pi r n square, scattering by nucleus, and here you multiply it by z. Okay, we have done it here. We have multiplied by n, but n here is z. Okay, z is basically your electron, your atomic number. So simply we can get. So now you can add them up and then multiply it by this n0 rho t is the thickness, and and then we get something closer to the what we saw last time. But we are going to throw away this equation because we have much close, because this is just for the back of the envelope calculation. We will have much better equation now, and that is actually used in electron microscopy and also X-ray diffraction. So now this is clear, that effect of Z, B, and theta on the image contrast, I think. Now let us go much deeper than beyond this formula. So let us understand the Rutherford cross section. So now we will take these two parts separately. Okay, you don't need to remember any of this equation. Please do not remember any of this equation. If you can remember this equation, it's fine. It is always advisable, and they are not very difficult also to remember. But you can at least remember this concept, that how as a function of z, v, and theta, electron scattering plays a role. Okay, and these things can be considered without any equation, only by purely by conceptual understanding. So I always emphasize on conceptual understanding, and I never encourage cramming the equations. So just by conceptual understanding, you should be able to answer this question, that if you increase the z, what will happen to the scattering cross section? If you increase the electron energy, what will happen to the electron scattering? And if you increase the theta, what will happen to the electron scattering? I hope without these equations, you can conceptually you can understand. If you are still having a problem in understanding the dependence of electron scattering on atomic number, the energy of the electron, and the scattering angle, please let me know. I will answer it again without using any equation. Please let me know. I hope you have all understood. Mm-hmm. And it was made clear in the previous lectures. Okay. So here I'll be showing some equations which are historical in nature, more than 110 year old, almost 110 year old equation, which were, in fact, this original experiment was done by the students of Rutherford. And initially Rutherford did not believe his students. So Rutherford students actually, like the way modern guides they do, students carry out the experiments. And then Rutherford actually put it together. Rutherford actually found out that it is against the plum pudding model, which was proposed by J.J. Thomson, right? J.J. Thomson gave this atomic model of plum pudding model. So this was a historical, I'm going to show you the same equation which was used by Rutherford. So I repeat that, so his students were convinced by some their fellow co-worker to bombard alpha particles on a target. And so many of the alpha particles turned back, they took U-turn. And so that was a surprising data. And Rutherford looked at the data of the students, which when the students brought that data back, and then he analyzed, and then that's why Rutherford is given the credit, okay, for the understanding which he developed. So here we are ignoring electron-electron scattering, which we will plug it later on. Let me tell you one secret that now what we are going to do in order to understand the electron interaction with a single atom, we have split this part into two parts, right? This problem into two parts, electron interaction with the nucleus and electron interaction with the with electron, another electron, like Z times electron, right? Now, we do not know how they interact. I mean, when I consider the equation part, though we don't need actually equation, but just for the sake of completeness, I'll give you some equations actually, right? Because some people like equations, okay? So I'll give you some equations. So this electron nucleus part, we borrow from Rutherford experiments. So we have in fact stolen this equation. So we are actually stealing the Rutherford equation. We are modifying it and we are using for electron, because Rutherford equation was given for alpha particles, which are completely different actually, which are actually two electrons stripped of helium atom, right? Okay, so those are actually positively charged, two positively charged plus two, okay? So we'll modify and we will use that for our purposes, okay? So we don't need to do hard work to reinvent these equations. So we are saving our hard work. So I'm saving your hard work also, okay? Second part is the electron-electron interaction, okay? This we are borrowing from X-ray people. Remember that I told you many times that X-rays interact with the electron cloud only, not with the nucleus. So we can borrow and also X-ray scattering cross section is proportional to Z, which is in our case also we will borrow that equation and plug in, and then we have a working equation. So that is the plan. I hope you understand the plan. You understand, Dr. Bhavna? Is it clear?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Anybody else? Who else? Rajkiran? Rajkiran, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, sir. I am here.
Okay. So let me expose you to the Rutherford equation. So this.
I know this equation.
Yeah. So we are ignoring actually low-angle electron-electron scattering for the time being. Then we will add it here. Okay, we'll add it here later on and concentrate only on electron nucleus interaction. So high angle electron, why it is important? This is important for your signal number. Your signal number 3 and 4, right? Your 3 and 4 decides the Z contrast. And So Hardoff and Rutherford backscattering will be answered by this equation, okay? So that's why it is extremely important. So this equation was actually, So Rutherford actually exactly 110 years back derived this expression for differential scattering cross section for high angle scattering by nucleus alone. Okay, so please note that differential scattering cross section I explained in the terminologies in the previous series. So this you can't understand anything if you don't understand this differential scattering cross section. So this was basically sigma r. R stands for Rutherford, and theta as scattering angle theta, e to the power 4, which you can ignore because that's just electron charge. And z square is important. You can see that it is proportional to z. Okay, so in terms of square, so if you increase z, so scattering probability of scattering will increase in the square term. Okay, and divide by 16, you can forget all these numbers, and epsilon zero is anyway constant. E zero is the electron energy. You can see now the bullets are faster, targets are smaller. So when you increase the electron energy, you can see that scattering cross section is going down if you are increasing this. Okay, now it is clear. Now theta is also in the when you increase the theta, this will again go down. So I think it's clear. Everything is clear. It's the same conclusions which we drew here, right? We are reaching to the same conclusion. Okay, now Rutherford cross section. Different books you may find different notation, but if you see it clearly, these equations are actually same. What I'm doing? I want to erase this? Yes. If you notice this equation, this is the same e to the power 4, right? You can see that this is. So Rutherford scattering cross section, differential scattering cross section was given for alpha particles, okay, helium atom minus 2 of its electrons. So here we are putting q, okay, q charge instead of e here, electron here, but q is essentially 2z e square divided by e. So ze is the charge on the target atom, 2 is the charge, 2e is basically the charge on the alpha particles which we are bombarding, right, instead of electrons. So so you can see the probability of scattering falls off quickly with the angle. Okay, if we replace alpha particles with electron, then we reach to this equation. Okay, yeah, and it's the same as this, almost the same. It's the same equation. So Rutherford expressions ignored many things, actually three things primarily, but you don't need to worry about these problems, and they became very, very serious. Actually, I used to go into detail for other set of students, but here you don't need to go into detail that he ignored the relativistic effects. Relativistic effects will be considered when the energy is very high. If the energy of this incoming electrons E is very high, then you know that you have to consider the relativistic effects. In the case of electron microscopy, you need to consider this relativistic effects if the energy is more than 200 kilo electron volt or higher. It also assumes, that's a problem, that it assumes that incident electron does not lose significant energy through the inelastic processes. So the energy of the electron is fixed. But when we consider elastic interaction, there is no interaction which is truly elastic. You have to consider subtle energy losses. So when this incoming electron or alpha particle, so you have, this is the atomic structure, you have these electrons orbiting around nucleus. So when this incoming electron or alpha particle, whatever, does not matter, approaches this atom, so what will happen, that now we are considering the its interaction with the nucleus. So here actually, when this electron penetrates this electron cloud, in order to reach to the nucleus, it has to penetrate the electron cloud. So it has, when it penetrates, it definitely has some interaction, weak interaction with these electrons. So there is a change in the slight changes in its energy. So there is always a change in this energy. Okay. So there is always, so it is not no longer elastic process, but Rutherford considered as if these electrons do not exist actually. And it was just for convenience, but it has severe problems. And third problem, which is associated with that, is that this electron cloud, for example, this charge on the nucleus is positive Z times E, but this incoming particle will never see this charge as positive Z times E, but it will be less than this. It will be always less than this because of the screening effect from negatively charged electrons. So this screening effect, I think you might have read it in 12th standard, I think 11th standard, 12th standard, they teach a little bit about screening effect. And it's, I think as chemistry students, you all know about screening effects. They're always explained. And by common sense also, you can understand when electron is trying to penetrate deeper. So this positively charged nucleus will be screened by these negatively charged electrons. So this charge is not exactly this, but it is less than this. So more number of electrons means outside means this more screening effect. So the consequence of screening effect were very serious. And so we have to consider the screening effect. We have to add this term. So we have to modify to the Rutherford cross-section considering this, so we don't do the same mistakes which Mr. Rutherford did. Considering all that, you don't need to really worry about all these things. Don't worry about this. So this actually, this A0 is the Bohr radius of the scattering atom.
Excuse me, sir?
Yes.
So can you please explain a little bit about relativistic effect?
Relativistic effects, I explained in the first lecture or second lecture, if you go back and check. Relativistic effects actually the velocity of the electron. Okay, I think there is a table somewhere. Let me check. I have a table here. Let me see. It is coming into this presentation also, but let me pull up the. तुम लोग यार भूल जाते हो पढ़ते नहीं हो सो रिलेटिविस्टिक फैक्ट्स एक्चुअली सो For example, we have certain energy of, we are given actually certain accelerating voltage, which is V. That's what we have actually, V. V is typically 100 kilo electron volt or 200 kilo electron volt, right? From this, we can calculate the kinetic energy, half mv square. And then we have basically the velocity of the electron, V, okay? Square root of 2 EV divided by M0. M0 is the rest mass. And now we can, from de Broglie's equation, because from de Broglie's equation, we can calculate the associated, the wavelength of the associated wave with this. So this is basically lambda. So that this is all non-relativistic. So relativistic effects. So this is all fine for the slow moving electrons when the electron velocity is less than half of the speed of light. So when the electron velocity becomes more than the half of the speed of light, so you can see that we have to add this relativistic correction, okay, this term. Okay, so you can refer to the theory of relativity, general theory of relativity, and there you have a set of rules. Okay, so the consequence of the relativistic corrections are following. You can see that immediately there is a decrease in the wave. There is basically decrease in the wavelength. You can see that the wavelength associated. This is the non-relativistic value, and here it is much significant from 200 kilo electron volt onwards. You can see this is the non-relativistic value. This is the actual one. This is the actual one. So you can see that this is less than non-relativistic. So this, I hope it explains.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Got it. Yeah. Thank you, sir.
Yes, so we'll modify it. So after we add the screening effect and relativistic corrections, so then we come to this equation. And don't remember this equation. I also don't force my brain to remember. I force my brain to understand the concept. If you ask me this equation, I mean, I have not even tried consciously to remember this equation. I have no intention to impress anyone by cramming this equation and telling that, oh, I remember this equation. I never in my career impress people with, you know, I know some people do that, but it makes no sense. You can always forget these equations and it does not mean much. So these are actually equations are, I would say that mathematics should be slave, not the master of science. Master is the concept, actually, the physical picture, the actual picture which you can frame in your mind. Equations just follow, actually. These equations are anyway, you know, that they are highly exponent. These are all wrong equations, actually. That they just serve purpose to some. Okay, I think all of you know that, all those things. So let me close this because I'm not feeling very good. But before giving you the conclusion. So now you can add up this. So this is the scattering cross section. So this equation basically gives you the probability. So for example, you're bombarding 1,000 electrons over your, this is your sample. So this equation tells you that in an angle from theta to theta plus d theta, in a small angular cross section, what is the probability that out of these 1,000 electrons, how many electrons will get scattered at particular this value theta plus theta. Suppose you want to calculate the total scattering cross section, which is actually meaningless because you always look for theta dependence, because you don't really want to it does not serve much purpose. But in fact, you can just integrate over total scattering cross section, which is not very useful, but you can do that. And you can always do that, right? So total nuclear scattering cross section for angle more than theta, you can get from this equation. And if you notice that your Z dependence, energy dependence, theta dependence is the same, actually, because it's a cot, actually, right? Not okay. Okay, so it will be inversely proportional to theta, right? Now this is the take home lesson, actually. What did we learn from this? How it is useful to us? So so this is the usefulness. This is beautiful, actually. These two slides are three slides. Actually tells you the crux of this. If you understand this, you have to spend a lot of time. And this is connected to the hardcore chemistry, materials chemistry, these three slides. That's it. And later on comes the application part. And this you already know, the application. You already know about HADAP. So this is basically repetition. It's all repetition, actually, nothing else. This is all repetition. I've already taught you this, all these things, okay? So you can see there is a lot of repetition in my slides. If you have not understood the form factor, you will understand it more also. Arey bhai chala ja, kya ho raha isko? Slide move nahi ho rahi hai. Dukhi kar rakha hai logon ne. Arey, to aadhi hai. I hate animations. Actually, sometimes animations create a lot of problems. Yeah. So let us understand this. So this is actually the plot. So what we have done, we have actually calculated electron nucleus elastic interaction. Elastic interaction. Right. We actually started. Okay. And now we have some equation which you do not need to remember, but you can plot it. You can logarithmically plot it. So this is actually logarithmic plot, and you can see this unit. These units are meter square. Okay. Please note that number one, these are logarithmic. This is logarithmic scale, and this unit is meter square. Obviously, because sigma is proportional to r square. It's a cross section. Fine. And target is copper. Suppose your sample is a copper, made of copper, and this is a scattering angle. So this basically is a physical representation of this experimental setup. Will be, suppose you have a copper sample of a particular thickness. Thickness is not given; it does not matter. So this basically tells you that if you bombard 100 kilo electron volt and 200 kilo electron volt. You can see that 100 kilo electron volt scattering cross section is larger than 200 kilo electron volt, and as a function of number one, so for any given target, so scattering cross section goes down. It is decreasing. Okay, so scattering cross section from so this is actually minus 22 is actually 0.1 angstrom, right? R is equal to 0.1 angstrom, right? And this is 0.2 angstrom, 1 picometer. Right? 10 to the power minus 12. So it is 10 to the power minus 12 meter, right? This is 0.1 picometer, 10 to the power minus 13 meter, R. I am calculating R because it is R square. And this is 10 to the power minus 14 meter. Which is actually 10 femtometer. Please note that this is extremely important. You can see that what you are looking at is that, for example, so in electron microscopy we do not look at such a large scattering angle. We are actually, if you note that, we are actually looking at very small scattering angle. We don't need these scattering angles, but it's just plotted. But you can see that. As a function of scattering angle, the probability is basically decreasing. You may actually it's. I wanted to tell you the seriousness. Basically, there is a, because it's a logarithmic scale, so you are not understanding the severity. But it is really dropping very fast. Order of magnitude, several order of magnitude changes there actually in the scattering cross section. And even from 100 to 200 kilo electron volt, there is a significant decrease. In the scattering cross section, actually, so scattering probability will be less if you increase the energy. And same thing, if you note here, for carbon, for example, if I draw a line here, straight line here. I'm sorry, it's not a straight line. So for a particular scattering angle, if you try to look at the cross section, so you can. Just rough estimate. It's not even rough. So for the same angle 60 degree, if you calculate the scattering cross section for the same beam energy 100 kilo electron volt, so carbon scatter two order of magnitude less. So scattering from carbon probability will be 100 times more, 100 times less. 100 times less between carbon to copper, and between gold. Gold is, for example, let's say it is here 10 to the power minus 23, and this is 10 to the power minus 26. Okay, I'm not taking R, I'm taking R square because that is the actual scattering area. Actually, you can see this is 1000 times. So gold scatter 1000 times more than carbon. That's the conclusion. So that's the reason that polymeric sample are difficult to give you less contrast. Same is with proteins and viruses. Virus samples and proteins, they are very difficult to image. So they have to stain it with uranyl acetate or something, heavy electron scatter. So people who do electron microscopy on viruses or other biological objects, for example, bacterial cells, mammalian cells. So they have to stain it with the high set element, it's called negative staining, whatever. So you can see that reason is that gold scatters 1000 times more than the carbon. Okay. And that also answers one more question when it comes to the sample preparation. So how thick your sample should be? So you can see that you can take, so suppose if you consider, if you compare between gold and copper, you can take, you can afford to take carbon much thicker than gold because there is not much scattering. So electrons are less likely to be stopped by carbon, and they're more likely to be stopped by gold, and that gives you a very good idea about mean free path. Now you can see this is beautiful this thing. So you can see that for gold, you can see, for example, you are taking 200 kilo electron volt energy, which is very common. So you can see that mean free path is actually the thickness which you should be taking. Mean free path is basically the distance traveled by electrons between two scattering events. So if you draw again a line here, if you draw a line here, a straight line here, straight line. So this is 100, and this is somewhere around 50, and this will be 25. So this is around 20 actually. So this is 20 nanometer. And if you take the same somewhere here for carbon, so carbon is actually 400 nanometers. I'm sorry. So now you can see. Oh, I'm sorry. So now you can see. Scattering cross section for carbon is 400 nanometer, and scattering cross section for gold is 20 nanometer for the electron energy 200 kilo electron volt. So what it tells you that if you want to do transmission electron microscopy, that means you are looking at transmitted electrons. So your sample thickness for gold should be less than 20 nanometer. Otherwise, you don't transmit the electrons. You can still get the particle morphology because suppose electrons are not transmitted. Suppose if you are taking gold particle, which is thickness is around 50 nanometer, and so what will happen that you are bombarding this and the sample. So you will get like a shadow effect. So you will see completely dark here, but you will not get HRTM. You will not get any diffraction images because there won't be any transmitted. Electrons will not transmit to the other side. If electrons are not transmitting to the other side, then you have no electrons to talk to get the information about the crystallography. So you will not get the information about the crystallography here, but you will still get the information about particle size and shape. Absolutely no problem. You get two-dimensional projection of three-dimensional objects. Okay, you understand? So it does not mean that you can't get information from gold particles which are larger than 20 nanometer. But another problem is the chromatic aberration. So your aberration, if it depends upon what you're trying to do. So if you're trying to do high resolution stuff, forget it. If you're trying to do, because you are introducing aberration, more and more problems if your sample is so thick. But we are just interested in just size and shape. Absolutely no problem. Even if your sample is too thick, look like 200, 300 nanometer, absolutely no problem. You can still see your particles. But if you are trying to see aberration corrected, high resolution stuff, then, or if you are trying to do, chemical analysis of atoms, atom-specific chemical analysis, some deeper, beyond just regular imaging, then you will. So that's the reason many times students do not see any fringe, lattice fringes, because sample is sometimes too thick. But if you are taking like polymers or some organic chemistry samples, so then you can afford to take a very thick sample. Some of the conclusions are, I thought this afternoon that I will keep it for you to read. So please read this slide. It is important for you, not for me. But I thought I'll leave some notes for you. Normally I used to hide this slide, but I thought I'll keep it with you. Okay. So this is a summary of what I was trying to teach you today. So I will end it here for you to meditate on these two important slides, which is basically result of our exercise of Rutherford scattering cross-section. So please remember our journey, starting from elastic scattering, and then we explained different kinds of interactions, and then we understood basically low angle scattering, and and then we borrowed this idea of Rutherford cross-section. And this, we borrowed this equation, and then from this equation, we directly carried out this analysis. What we will do next, we will plug in. So this is basically electron nucleus part. So please remember that now, I told you that we have split the problem into two parts. One is electron-electron interaction. Second is electron nucleus interaction. So second part is completed today. So we have to add to this equation. So we have to add in the next lecture, we will add to this electron-electron interaction. Then our equation will be complete. But in this form, also it's beautiful actually equation, and then we learn quite a lot about So now we will draw some conclusions about practical applications more than what should be the thickness. So these are the practical applications of these equations. So this is please remember, this is all happening from a single atom. Please remember that. That's why you don't see any structure here. You don't see any diffraction pattern. So when you plug in the structure factor, so these equations will not be as smooth. So they will be like this. These curves will be like this when you plug in. This is nothing but atomic form factor. My student Supriya likes this word, so I thought of using it. Okay, so this is basically atomic form factor. So what you see on your screen is atomic form factor. So if you plug in the structure factor to this equation, so what will be the shape? Are yaar aage ho chuka. Yes, I do a lot of khichdi. So this is basically atomic form factor, which falls like this. And if we plug in the structure factor, how the different atoms are placed into the lattice, so the resultant will be basically very close to the electron diffraction pattern. Okay, so this is basically intensity zero, and this is intensity zero. So you can see, this is similar to the X-ray diffraction pattern, powder X-ray diffraction pattern, which you see when you do the. So then it's the repetition of previous lecture series, but in a more deeper ways. So I hope you understand these concepts clearly. If you have any question, please let me know.